members present, I declare the motion passed. Third reading, Safeguarding National Security Bill, Secretary for Security. President, I move that the Safeguarding National Security Bill be read the third time and do pass. I now propose the question to you that the Safeguarding National Security Bill be read the third time and do pass. Mr. Ronick Chen. President, on behalf of the 18 other members of G19, I support the passage of the third reading of the Safeguarding National Security Bill so that we fulfill the constitutional duty under Article 23. We plug this loophole in our national security. The other 18 members and I are honored to be able to be part of this historic mission. Whatever challenges may come in the future, we will remain steadfast in upholding national security. We will defend this law. Once we have this protective barrier, we will see a more stable business environment. Hong Kong will be a safer place, a more open place, a more inclusive place, so that we can then zero in on the economy and deliver a better life for people. And then we can go from stability to prosperity. Everyone in Hong Kong will be able to go about their lives. I so submit, I support the passage of the third reading. Mr. Ben Chen. President, legislation for Article 23 of the Basic Law is a constitutional duty of the HKSAR. We have come to this juncture of great historic significance. The DAB hopes that LegCo can pass this Safeguarding National Security Bill so that this can be a significant gift for the upcoming 27th anniversary of Hong Kong's return to our country. Safeguarding national security is the prerequisite for a good life for people in the city. We support this bill so that we can cope with the past, present, and future national security risks and challenges. At the same time, we must improve the legal system and enforcement mechanisms for keeping our country safe. We need to stick to the May 28th decision of the NPC and also the national security law. We need to build up this protective barrier to keep our country safe. President, we need to keep our country safe. Only then we can keep Hong Kong safe. We need to keep our country safe, and only then we can keep our community safe. On behalf of the DAB, I support the passage of this bill so that Hong Kong can go ahead with the peace of mind to develop its economy and improve people's lives. I so submit. Mr. Andrew Lam. President, I represent the C15 Plus group. We support the passage of this bill so that we can complete our constitutional duty of safeguarding national security. The stronger our protective barrier, the stronger the belief in one country, the better we can leverage the two systems, the greater prosperity we can encourage. As we are going our last mile in this work, I thank the Bills Committee's chairman and the members for driving the work. I thank the government officials and departments for doing their respective jobs. Everyone's doing their best on this legislative exercise. The C15 Plus members and I look forward to voting on this bill so that we can take part in and witness this historic moment. Mrs. Regina Ip, on behalf of the six members from the New People's Party, I express my support for the early passage of this bill at the third reading. This is a great demonstration of the practice of one country, two systems. Before 1997, the central authorities gave us room. The central government gave us the opportunity to legislate on our own for Article 23. That shows great accommodation that the central authorities has shown. More than 26 years of delay, we are finally here. We are completing our constitutional duty. Just like other members, I believe once this bill is enacted, we will see greater development. The government will be able to better focus on the economy and improve people's lives. And we will also promote this law as a law that is in line with human rights protections and the international covenants on human rights. This can also show that this law is in line with the rule of law. I so submit, Mr. Peter Hsu. President, on behalf of the Liberal Party, I reiterate the support of the Liberal Party for this bill. Businesses have told me this bill can plug the loophole in national security. This law will also converge with the national security law. We will build a stronger protective barrier and also leverage the unique advantages we have under one country, two systems. The Liberal Party is pleased to see that we have come to the final step of this legislative exercise. We're close to completing the legislation. Then this is a profound moment. With this enactment, we look forward to seeing long-term stability. And then we can have peace of mind and focus on the economy and improve people's lives. We can also contribute to our country's prosperity. Mr. Kingsley Wong. President, on behalf of the FTU, I speak in support of this bill. Back in 2002, the FTU and other groups expressed their support for legislation for national security to fulfill Hong Kong's constitutional duty. 22 years later, this collection of groups supporting the legislation are finally seeing the completion of the job. Different labor groups unanimously support the passage of this bill. This points to the necessity and importance of the bill. More than 98% of the respondents of the public consultation support this bill. Getting this bill through means responding to those popular calls. This bill can help us meet national security risks. We can remove the barriers to our development. We can then focus on the economy and improve people's lives. Everyone can lead a good life in the city. I so submit, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. President, legislating for Article 23 of the Basic Law is Hong Kong's constitutional duty. This is also about protecting Hong Kong, ensuring peace and stability in Hong Kong, in our country. This bill is also in line with the rule of law. The bill strikes a proper balance between national security and protection of human rights. We're finally here at the third reading. The BPA supports this bill, and we are most honored to be able to cast a vote of support for this bill. This bill is overdue for more than 20 years, and we're finally at the final step. We are honored to be part of it. And we also have mixed feelings. This is a day to be remembered. I so submit. On behalf of the BPA and businesses we represent, and also the public, we support the passage of this bill at third reading. Ms. Starry Lim. The Safeguarding National Security Bill has gone through the second reading. Members have spoken. We have taken on board the comments, suggestions from all walks of life. We have also seen the government adopt the suggestions. Now we have come to the bill as amended. We have come to the third reading of the bill. I thank the public for their attention to this bill. I thank the government officials and their team for working tirelessly on this bill. I also thank all LegCo members, the LegCo Secretariat, for their work on scrutinizing the bill. With the bill's passage, we are finally completing the constitutional duty to our country, to the people, and we're finally plugging the loophole in national security for more than 20 years, and we can ensure security for our city and for everyone. After this bill is passed, we can work together and focus on the economy and better integrate into our country's development, especially the Greater Bay Area development. We can improve people's lives and contribute to our country's development. And then we can continue to leverage our strength with our country's support and global connectivity, and we have a bright future. With this bill's passage, we are only reaching a new start. We still have to work on national security education. We still have to explain the new law. Everyone needs to play their part. Our officials also need to do their job. We need to tell the outside world about the new law. I support this bill so that we can all work together on completing the constitutional duty.
Does any other member wish to speak? Secretary for Security, would you like to speak? Secretary, please. President, over the past week, the Council held back-to-back meetings to scrutinize the bill. Now, the bill is soon to be read for the third time. As the official in charge, my feelings are mixed. On one hand, I'm thrilled to witness the birth of Article 23, my own flesh and blood, my child. On the other hand, I lament the years of toil and frustration preceding the birth of the bill. We're able to witness the birth of Article 23 today. It is because of the hard work of the government and the Legislative Council. And more importantly, it is because the members of the public understand the importance of the legislation for prosperity in Hong Kong. After the 2019 Colour Revolution, there is a consensus that upholding national security, sovereignty and development interests is a key to our long-term success. Having witnessed the stabilizing effects brought about by the Hong Kong National Security Law, there is a solid popular opinion that we should engage in legislation for national security. The bill has swiftly proceeded from conception, public consultation, to today's council debate. This is the last step. The credit belongs to the entire team. Before it is put to vote, I would like to thank the leadership of the chief executive and the support from central authorities, as well as the entire civil service, as well as the DOJ and the Security Bureau's colleagues who worked tirelessly to draft the law, scrutinize the bill, and explain the bill. That's why we can complete the extraordinary task in time. I also thank the President, Bills Committee's Chairman, BC members, as well as every member. Your invaluable views are very important for the legislation as well as the implementation of the law and our national security work. I have to thank political parties, groups, and friendly bodies outside the Council, which mobilize members to explain the bill to the general public. They also mounted strong rebuttal against groundless smearing and sent a positive message. I thank the general public for supporting the implementation of Article 23, the 528 decision, as well as the Hong Kong NSL. We are fulfilling a constitutional duty. Your support means a lot for us. This will also ensure the steadfast success of One Country, Two Systems. With the passage and coming into effect of the Safeguarding National Security Ordinance, it will complement local legislation and the national security mechanism in forming a complete legal system for safeguarding national security. But that doesn't mean that our work for upholding national security is completed. On the contrary, since resumption of second debate, many members said that after passage of the bill, we have to continue with our publicity and public education work. I fully agree with them. That's why the Secretary for Justice and myself have packed our schedule with a series of explanatory sessions to promote the relevant law to the public. We will continue to provide and update relevant information on the internet and encourage the public to understand the law better. This is important for the smooth implementation of the law. I believe that with a complete set of legal system for safeguarding national security and also a more comprehensive understanding of national security among the public, we can enjoy long-lasting stability. President, I so submit, I implore members to support the third reading of the Safeguarding National Security Bill. Thank you. I now propose the question to you. Does the Safeguarding National Security Bill be read the third time and do pass? Mr. Martin Liao claims the division. The division bell will be rung for 5 minutes. Members, please return to your seats. Voting begins. Please check your votes. Voting is closed. There being no question, voting is closed. Please display the results. 89 present, 89 for. Unanimous.
Carried.
I declare the motion passed. Safeguarding National Security Bill. Members, as the President of the Legislative Council, I will not vote in usual circumstances. However, legislation for Article 23 is not just any other piece of legislation. It relates to the national security in Hong Kong. It is of the utmost importance. So at this historical moment, I will vote in favor of the bill together with you. The Safeguarding National Security Ordinance highlights the importance of safeguarding national security by every individual. I've just been informed that after the passage of the bill, in accordance with rules of procedure, 8A, the Chief Executive will attend the Council and speak to members. I'm aware that the Chief Executive is already here. I will invite the Chief Executive to enter the chamber. Please remain standing.
The Chief Executive. Welcome, Chief Executive, to today's Council meeting. Chief Executive will now address the Council. Chief Executive, President of the Legislative Council, members, this is a historic moment for Hong Kong. We've waited for 26 years, 8 months, and 19 days for today. The sixth term of the Hong Kong SAR government and the seventh term of the Legislative Council have jointly completed this historic mission. This is our moment to be proud. We've fulfilled the constitutional duty on Article 23 enactment. We've completed the historic mission. The Safeguarding National Security Bill has been read the third time and been passed. This is the 10th anniversary of President Xi Jinping's holistic view of national security. This year, we completed Article 23 legislation. We've fulfilled our constitutional duty and completed the historic mission. We live up to the country's expectation. I'm going to sign the Safeguarding National Security Bill. This bill will be gazetted on the 23rd of this month. Safeguarding National Security Ordinance will come into effect on the 23rd of March 2024. Safeguarding National Security Ordinance will help us effectively prevent, suppress, and punish acts and activities endangering national security, including infiltration and sabotaging activities by external forces. We can effectively guard against color revolution and also those advocating Hong Kong independence. We will never be afraid of mutual destruction again, and for rioters to hurl petrol bombs and vandalize properties in Hong Kong, endangering the lives of Hong Kong people. From now on, Hong Kong people will never have to experience the pain that we've experienced before. There are three principles to safeguarding national security. These principles are set out in the ordinance. First, the highest principle of one country, two systems is to safeguard the sovereignty, unity, and territorial integrity of the state, and that human rights and freedoms are safeguarded in accordance with the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, as well as the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights, as applied to the Hong Kong SAR. And human rights, including the freedoms of speech, of the press and of publication, the freedoms of association, of assembly, of procession, and of demonstration safeguarded under the Basic Law. The third principle is that for acts and activities endangering national security, there must be adherence to active prevention in accordance to the rule of law and suppression and punishment according to the law. There are also three objectives. That is, we must resolutely, fully and faithfully implement the policy of one country, two systems under which Hong Kong people administer Hong Kong with a high degree of autonomy. Two, to establish and improve the legal system and enforcement mechanisms for the Hong Kong SAR to safeguard national security. And three, to prevent, suppress and punish acts and activities endangering national security according to the law and to protect the lawful rights and interests of residents of Hong Kong SAR and other people here, to ensure the property and investment in the Hong Kong SAR are protected by the law and to maintain prosperity and stability of the Hong Kong SAR. There are also four features of this ordinance. The Safeguarding National Security Ordinance has high degree of convergence, complementarity, and compatibility with the Hong Kong national security law. Reference has been made to other common law jurisdictions in drawing up the bill. However, we also have regard to actual circumstances in Hong Kong for its implementation. Common sense approach is taken in drafting the bill. It's easy to understand, and we've also repealed obsolete provisions. On the 25th of January this year, at the Chief Executive Interactive Questions and Answers session, I announced the start of the legislative exercise. Immediately afterwards, on the 30th of January, I started the public consultation, which lasted until the 28th of February. The government received 13,000 submissions. 98.6% of them make positive and supportive comments. There is a strong public mandate for Article 23 enactment. I thank the Legislative Council for convening the Council meeting for the first and second reading of the bill, as well as the incessant work of the Bills Committee meeting, as well as the support of the House Committee, followed by the resumption of a second reading and third reading of the bill today. All these demonstrates the importance of this bill and that we should enact on Article 23 as early as possible. One day sooner is one day earlier, so that we can fulfill the constitutional duty long awaited for 26 years, 8 months and 19 days. I'd like to thank Mr. Andrew Leung, President of the Legislative Council, for his understanding of the necessity and urgency of Article 23 enactment. early meetings and special meetings have been called in order to safeguard national security. At the same time, he made sure that there is due process. Every morning, according to the president, he would receive messages from a number of members, all discussing matters relating to Article 23 enactment. So to him, the moment he woke up, to the moment he turns in, all he thought about was Article 23. He shared the same goal as other members in completing the legislative exercise, and this is motivation for all of us. I also thank members of the Bills Committee, including Chair Mr. Martin Liao, Mr. Gary Chan, Deputy Chair, and as well as 13 other members. They have worked tirelessly for 7 days. They work from 9 a.m. to 7 p.m. every day, and they even deliberated at length on a particular provision. For example, they spent 1 hour and 20 minutes on just one clause. And there are also many clauses which took members more than 30 minutes to go through. The House Committee established a subcommittee on matters relating to Article 23 legislation. And together with the meetings of the subcommittee, 25 meetings have been held, totaling over 50 hours. Members also put forward over 1,000 questions. In the end, the administration proposed 91 amendments. Members have all dedicated their efforts to complete the legislative work with great efficiency. Mr. Martin Liao is chairman of the Bills Committee. As I understand, in order to facilitate the smooth conduct of the Bills Committee's work, he made ample preparations in light of possible matters requiring the chairman's ruling. In the end, no ruling was required because all members did their homework and the chair did not have to rule on anything. All members acted as one, and he feels encouraged by the unity of members. I also thank Ms. Dari Li, Chair of the House Committee, and all other members for their full support of the administration's proposal for this bill to be tabled in the Council as early as possible. Ms. Dari Li is an NPC delegate, and in fact, she traveled to and from Beijing twice during the two sessions. According to her, it's a very hard-to-forget experience, but hard to come by. We followed all the established procedures in going through the bill. Members have also been very serious about examining the bill. Members deliberated on a number of matters, including the philosophy of the bill and the details, so on and so forth. They all abide by the objective of completing the legislative exercise as early as possible. So we've done the work with great efficiency and with quality. This bill has been read the third time, and this is the high point of patriotism. We all feel honored to have completed this important mission of safeguarding national security bill. I also thank the government for their contribution in this regard. I also thank the Secretary for Justice as well as the Department of Justice. In particular, I thank Mr. Paul Lam, Secretary for Security, Secretary for Justice, Mr. P.K. Tang, Secretary for Security, as well as other government officials. They've helped in rebutting arguments, and they've also done a lot of explanation to LegCo members with dedication. I remember I called the DOJ's office and the Security Bureau's office a number of times, and by the time we ended the conversation, I took a look at the clock, and it was already 2 or 3 in the morning. And I really appreciate their dedication. They are the heroes, and I feel proud. Finally, I thank all patriots for supporting this bill, and for those who support Article 23 enactment, so that we can now fulfill the constitutional duty and draw a close to what we've been waiting for 26 years, 8 months, and 19 months. days so that we create a new chapter in history. With Article 23 enactment, we can better safeguard national security so that we, after plugging all loopholes, we can all focus our energy on economic development and improving people's livelihood so that we can build a better home for all of us. This is a historic moment. We feel proud and encouraged. And this is also a moment in which we turn a new chapter in our history. Thank you. Once again, I thank the Chief Executive for coming to this council and addressing the council in person at this historic moment. Today, we witnessed the joint efforts made by the legislature and the executive so that we successfully fulfilled the objective of enacting on Article 23 of the Basic Law. I believe, same as everyone here, we are all confident that with passage of the bill, we can have a better future for Hong Kong as well as our country. I now invite the chief executive, government officials, and all legislative members, as well as all government officials and colleagues taking part in this legislative process to stay behind for a group photo to be a witness to this historic moment. The next council meeting is scheduled for 11 a.m. tomorrow. The council is now adjourned.